former Pro Bowl linebacker Sean Merriman. All right, let's move to the NFL, which is about to celebrate its 100th anniversary, and the Pro Football Hall of Fame has come up with an interesting way to celebrate, announcing a plan to induct 20 new honorees instead of their usual maximum of 8. The group would include 5 modern players, 10 seniors, 3 contributors, and 2 owners, and still has to be approved by the board. But Hall CEO David Baker supports the idea, explaining, quote, "It's an extremely elite company, and it's not the Hall of Very, Very Good. It's the Hall of Fame, so it should be difficult to make it. But there's a lot of guys through the years who have slipped through the cracks. We have several guys who are on all-decade teams who aren't in the Hall of Fame. So this is an opportunity with the centennial coming up." I completely disagree with David Baker. The NFL, to me, or the Pro Football Hall of Fame, has been letting in too many players, and they should actually be going the opposite direction. It's got to remain the Hall of Fame, not the Hall of Very, Very Good. I just think there's too many guys politicking to get in, and they're bending to the politics.
Is it bad that it only happens once? Because this is not something that's going to be reoccurring. Because to celebrate the centennial part of it, I like it from that perspective that you do it one time. You're celebrating the greatness, not only of the players, but of the sport. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're talking about increasing the number of Hall of Fame players and contributors after this, that's something different. But for this one time, I like that.
Yeah, and I feel the same way. You know, I had the honor of going out for Ray Lewis's, for LaDainian Tomlinson. I seen the guys who were getting in with the shoe-ins. You know the guys going to first ballot, they're getting in no matter what. You almost don't even have to vote for these guys. You know they're getting in. Look at the people that's still in this list, right? That probably won't have a chance to get in anytime soon. Steve Hutchinson, Edgerrin James, John Lynch, Steve Atwater. You telling me these guys aren't Hall of Famers? So if you do this one time and allow some of these guys to get in, you can go back to what you used to do. But it's some of these guys that 100% deserve to be in the Hall of Fame that will not have a chance because their time is going to lapse. Once you go, what, a certain number of times, then you get removed from the list. Some of these guys need to get in, and they deserve to get in.
The problem with that is what I've seen is once you make an exception, people go back to that exception. And you're going to open the door even further because there are going to be other guys. You're going to say, well, if these guys slip through the cracks, what about these guys? And it becomes a wider field. I saw this happen with the Basketball Hall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
In 2009, the inductees were Michael Jordan, David Robinson, Jerry Sloan, John Stockton, and C. Vivian Stringer. You couldn't find a stronger 5. It re-energized the whole Basketball Hall of Fame concept. Since then, every year, they've had no less than 10 inductees. And we've added people like Phil Knight, George Raveling, Gary Williams, Oscar Schmidt, Goose Tatum. I'm not saying that any of those people don't deserve to be in, but there has now become this thing. And I know that Jerry Colangelo, when he took over as the director, was, hey, we've missed some people. Well, there was also the idea that we wanted to generate more attention. And that's the difficulty that I have. I feel as if everybody is fighting for the attention of people. So if we widen the scope, we're going to get more
attention. And I believe the NFL, they have done it before, right? Some years ago. I don't know if it was in the 60s or 70s. A long time ago,
When they first started. They let 17 guys in. And that was their first class, 44 years of NFL history, and they let 17 guys in. I just think it's a gigantic mistake because you know how you judge a Hall of Fame a lot of times? By the guys that don't get in.
Mm.
That's how, again, we used to say in journalism, you know how you wrote a great story? Is because of the stuff that was left in the cutting room floor that you were like, man, that was really good. I couldn't make the story. That's a great story.
These guys have so much help nowadays. You got social media involved. You got TV. You got the internet. You have more opportunity. You have YouTube, right? I mean, I look at some of my stuff is still on YouTube, right? But before then, you don't see a lot of guys' highlight tapes and what they've done on YouTube. So you have more opportunities to do it now. If you get past of some of these guys, like I just named, if you don't put them in the Hall of Fame, 5, 10, 15 years from now, these guys will never have an opportunity to go because we're just so internet-friendly. We're so social media-friendly. Yeah. And all these things help guys nowadays get in.
Look, Sean, I'm going to say this, and people are going to be very upset when I say this, and I don't mean to be disrespectful. But, you know, I wanted to be in the Hall of Fame, too. I didn't qualify. I wasn't good enough. I never made the NFL. I wasn't good enough. I was a mediocre mid-major player. Just because guys want to get in doesn't mean they should get in. And there's a lot of guys that want to get in and have a legitimate some of an argument. The guys you rattled off all have a case. But you got to draw the line somewhere. You know, I hate to be disrespectful of any Hall of Fame football player because, you know, I'm a groupie for Hall of Fame football players. And that's where I wanted to be. But I've seen some guys where I'm just like, no, they were never the best at their position. And I saw a guy, I'm going to name one guy because it irritated me. Harry Carson whined and complained and threatened, I won't even go if they put me in, blah, blah, blah. And then the next thing you know, they put him in. And I was like, yeah. No damn Hall of Fame.
The other part is, doesn't this devalue the people that were going through the selection process previously? The people that were voting and selecting? Aren't you suggesting, hey, you know what? You guys were recognized enough to make these selections, but you didn't quite get it right. We got to clean up your mess. And I'm not sure that that's fair either.
Well, I don't know if it's devaluing. I think you are given an opportunity to correct some errors that were missed. Okay?
But what are we basing that on?
You're basing it on going against a guy like Ray Lewis, right, who was a shoo-in. Randy Boss, who's a shoo-in. LaDainian Thomas, who's a shoo-in. So that automatically removes one or two spots every single year. You know, Champ Bailey, that removes spots, three spots, right? So now if you take those three and put those in there, how many spots do you have left to another guy has to wait another 5 years to go back up again?
But if that's the measurement, and it's always been the measurement, that this is just the reality of it, this is how many guys get in, then, yeah, maybe you are a little bit of prey of how good was your generation or how was your era. But that's been the case for decades and decades, so now we're changing, we're moving the goalposts, we're changing the dynamic and suggesting, well, you know what, that's the way it's always been, but we're going to make an exception here. Again, I think it waters down the value. The fact that guys are really great players and well-respected and don't get in adds the value to those who do.
Here's the thing, but comparing like the NFL and the NBA is totally different because the NBA is watered down just because of the international presence, okay?
Yeah, well, it's not an NBA Hall of Fame. Well, it's a basketball Hall of Fame. It's women, it's coaches, it's everything.
So it's a lot different in regards to them opening it up to more people compared to football. To me, I'm saying if you do this one time, and that's it in that regard, then that's totally different than opening it up after that. You feel me?
I'd be okay with that. I'm just not lying that it's going to be one time.
Let me ask you this, Sean, on a serious note. Again, you would know better than I would, but I see a lot of guys that everybody wants to get in because it's a way to really legitimize your career. But I also think a lot of guys complain and want in because it's a money-making opportunity. They put that gold jacket on you, and that's about $200,000 a year that gets put in your pocket just for being a Hall of Famer.
And that has something to do with it. We saw ED, right? ED said, hey, we should get $300,000 a year for the rest of our life. No, I get that part of it, but you got to look at guys like Terrell Davis, right? There are some guys who didn't get in the first time around who are not complaining. I know T.O. was one of the things. He probably should have been in the first time, but we have other guys that are not complaining. So we can't take the one bad apple, what you named before, and say that's the standard across the board because, guys, I keep going. Tony Boselli, right? We can keep going on this list on and on and on. I remember how great of a tackle he is. A guy that's coming up right now and is playing right now. Do you remember how great Tony Boselli was? No, I do. I remember watching him growing up. Mm-hmm. So as long as you get away from watching these guys and knowing who they are, you don't give an equal opportunity or chance. So I'm with you on that. I think that they should do it one time. If they want to do it in another 10 or 15 years from now, fine, but go back to that standard.
Here's what I think is happening that people aren't aware of. David Baker, the head of the Hall of Fame, and the voters, they're getting pressure virtually daily from former players. Why not me? How can I get in? Or their representatives are contacted. How can they get in? It's a shame. And that's what they're succumbing to, that they're trying, if we just get rid of these 15 guys and get them in, people will stop complaining. And it's like that you feed a cat, trust me, he's going to be back on your front door again, and there's going to be a new set of guys. I can name, you name Tony Boselli, I'm going to give you a name of someone that I know damn well is a Hall of Fame player, but will never get in, and you'll never hear me whine about it. But just in terms of performance, Brian Waters.
Yep.
That dude
balled
out, was a beast. He'll never get in, but he could deserve a Hall of Fame. And one of my best friends in the NFL, but I won't go on some rant and because he didn't earn it. He needed a couple more things to make it a no-brainer. I wish they'd only let the no-brainers in, to be honest with you. Coming up, people on Twitter are obsessed with my hair. I'm about to reveal the truth about it. TV's hottest looking social media.